A half hour with. I'm Pete Hammond, your host here today, and the half hour we're spending with is with the movie I'm Your Man, which is the official German entry for Best International Film at the Academy Awards. It also became the first film to win the Gender Neutral Acting Award at the Berlin International Film Festival for Maren Egert, who was one of the stars and has been wildly acclaimed. Just a wonderful comedy with a lot to say about the life we're living right now. And I'm so happy here today to have not only its star, but also its co-writer and director. First up is Maria Schrader, who you might know from a lot of movies because she's also an actor and a very famous one. Amy and Jaguar, one movie that went international, and she's won many awards and things for that, and also became the first German director ever to win an Emmy for the limited series Unorthodox. And that was just a couple of years ago. So welcome, Maria.
Thank you, Pete. Thank you.
Yeah. And then you all know Dan Stevens from so many things, Downton Abbey, Legion, Eurovision, Call of the Wild, Her Smell, Bly Spirit, on a Beauty and the Beast, The Man Who Invented Christmas. I'm doing your whole career, Dan. But he plays the humanoid robot, as it were, the perfect man in this movie. So welcome, Dan Stevens.
Thanks for having me, Pete.
Yeah. Happy to have both of you. Now, before we go on and I show a bit of this movie, actually, I want to show the trailer. Maria, can you sort of set it up and tell us, you know, a short synopsis of what the film is?
Okay. Alma, a woman in the midst of her 40s, a scientist at the famous Pergamon Museum, is asked to take a 3 weeks test with this new developed humanoid robot who is designed to be her perfect partner in life and love, to evaluate if these machines would be allowed to be part of society and have to carry passports, being allowed to work and marry.
Well, that's a perfect description of what it is. And it becomes really a sophisticated, it's almost a throwback to the great sophisticated screwball comedies that Hollywood used to turn out in its own way, but very contemporary. And we're going to talk about all that, but I want them to get a further taste of it. So let's take a look at the trailer of I'm Your Man.
Steht ein Mann.
Ach der, das ist kein Mann. Das ist ein Roboter. Die testen mich, scannen mein Gehirn. Multiple choice, ohne Ende. Und was kommt dann dabei raus?
Dein Traumpartner ist ja schon für dich gebaut.
Pass mal auf, Tom. Ich bin nicht auf der Suche nach einem Partner. Ich gehöre zu den Leuten, die euch 3 Wochen testen und dann ein Gutachten schreiben.
Und an Liebe bist du gar nicht interessiert.
0,0.
Etwas, wovon 93% der deutschen Frauen träumen.
Dann kommst du vielleicht selber drauf, zu welcher Gruppe ich gehöre.
Guten Morgen.
Ich weiß nicht, ob es Ihnen auffällt, aber Sie behandeln Tom wie eine Maschine.
Woran liegt das Ihrer Meinung nach? Dass er eine Maschine ist?
Unterschätzen Sie ihn vielleicht?
Also, wie ist das jetzt mit deinem Schwanz? Das ist also der Schwanz, den ich mir wünsche.
Anscheinend.
Es gibt einen Graben zwischen uns.
Ich gehe hier zurück und dann werde ich gelöscht. Heißt es bei euch nicht, Liebe überwindet alle Grenzen?
I love that line. This is what 93% of German women want. Guess which one? I'm in there. The 7%. That's so perfect. Maria, how did you come upon this? It was a short story, I think. You teamed up with another writer here to adapt it. But what sparked for you when you came upon this?
the love story, to tell a love story about two misfits. the simple setup, the potential for comedy, and then also the potential for more than just a romantic comedy, because the romantic comedy kind of demands that you want these two people become a couple. And with a setup between a woman and a machine, you're not really sure if you want them to become a couple. So it asks a lot of questions. It's an interesting field to investigate. And I think it will soon be happening, something like that.
Would you like that to make you happy? Meet the perfect man. Actually, he's supposed to be the perfect man, but not German. Here in the production of it, you wanted an actor from somewhere else who could speak German, but not perfect German. You have to develop it along the way, and with a British accent. I mean, how do you cast this role, and how did you? Because obviously, you got the perfect actor for it.
Yes, I totally agree. I couldn't be happier. Yes, since this is not a classical sci-fi, since we don't provide the film with all these future elements, and also not Tom with, superficial powers. And so it's just an agreement between the audience and the film that this actor is not a human, he's a robot, right? It's almost a fairy tale agreement. So I thought it would be really, really interesting, since this is my first German speaking film, to not present the German audience someone they see like on a daily prime time, right, regular basis, and think, oh, now he's the investigator in this film, now is the robot in the next film. So I thought it's interesting to find an international actor with a slice of strangeness in his language. And so we were on the search, in various countries. And this is how Dan and I met. And we met in a Zoom meeting like we do, and I knew he can speak German, and I of course had a closer look into his work, and I thought this might be perfect, and it turned out that we were a good match for this.
Yeah, Dan, I mean, how did you learn German? I mean, that you became so fluent in it.
I studied it in school, and we had some family friends who lived in Germany, and we used to go on holiday there a lot from the UK. And I think just in studying it, it was one of those things. I've always enjoyed languages, but this, the German language particularly, I fell in love with. And I've had the opportunity to act in German a couple of times now. This one was, I would say, much more challenging for all sorts of reasons. I've always found it a very, very beautiful language. And a lot of people, especially in the UK, would disagree with me. And so I had to go and make a romantic comedy just to prove my point, I think.
And, it's an interesting character because he can't start out perfectly. In German, you have to watch him sort of stumble. And I mean, right from that opening scene there, that he's finding his way too, which is a real trick as an actor.
Yes, it's a funny balance in that his German is actually perfect. It's almost too good. He's almost too correct. And it was something I was sort of realizing the other day, in that, there is a sort of genre that this kind of falls into, in that it's that sort of outsider dropped into our world, whether it's a caveman or an alien or something, Wonder Woman or someone, just sort of, plopped into the modern world, and how do they get on? And normally the comedy comes from them getting it wrong. But in our film, I think particularly in the beginning, the comedy comes from him getting it right and being too correct. And so it's the very complicated language just right, but realizing that it's wrong in this situation for Alma. And so calibrating those mistakes. And I think hopefully Tom makes fewer and fewer mistakes as the film goes on, and he becomes more human and learns what Alma wants and needs and what he can provide for her.
Yeah. And you look at this, how did you differ from the short story here in adapting this, your process in writing it, making it cinematic, Maria? And exactly. And, you know, it really does spark for me. I had watched Philadelphia Story in the pandemic, maybe a couple of months before I saw this movie. And when I saw this movie, I thought, oh, my God, they do make movies like they used to. You know, there is that kind of, it was just a coincidence when I found out that that was an inspiration for this, which I had no idea.
That's a great compliment, Pete. Thank you. Yes, as Dan said, there is some kind of sophistication about Tom. He's very well educated, and the language is almost too good to be true and very inappropriate for, let's say, you know, approaching a woman or flirting, or, you know, it's a very bizarre mixture of masculinity and obviously a very good looking protagonist like Cary Grant, like Jimmy Stewart, but then paired with an unusual naivety because he really wants to make it right. His purpose, he's, you know, he only exists to make Alma happy. So he's one of these very, very, very few individuals, when he asks the questions, he really wants to know the answer and not actually asking a questions like we usually do to talk about ourselves. He's free from egotismus and self-interest. And that is something sensational at the end also for Alma, real attention.
How important was it to present this in contemporary times right now, rather than go all sci-fi and go into the future, do it now, because it's believable with all the algorithms that we have conversations with and things like that, you know, this is not far-fetched at all.
Exactly. That's a very good question. And actually, the short story is set in a future world where robots are already part of the society. And we started out writing a future world. And then, thank God, we turned around and thought maybe it's much more interesting to put it right here where we're at. And Alma does not know anything more about the future than we do. And the only element is Tom, this very, very sophisticated new generation of robots and the company. So I think that's almost a fairy tale. It allows us to focus on this thought, you know, we are not focusing on, oh, there are new cars and they have new computers and what is the political aspect of the new world they're creating. No, it's just here and now, and we can relate to Alma and this weird encounter and concentrate on asking ourselves, how would we react to this?
Dan, talk about working with Maren Egger. Here, who is so wonderful here, but her character has such resistance to this whole idea, and it's only doing it because she's involved in this experiment. It's the classic rom-com setup in that, the, you know, yin and yang of that relationship. How did you develop that with her?
Yeah, well, in that sense, there is this sort of a pattern of the screwball comedy to it. And I think it is, you know, what Maria is so playful with in both the screenplay and in the film is that, you know, setting up Alma as somebody who is vehemently against the idea of this, thinks it's totally ridiculous. Her intellect and her main occupation is with, you know, cuneiform and sort of poetry from 4,000 years ago. And, you know, she couldn't be further from the sort of type that would embrace this kind of thing. And, you know, we show the audience many ways in which Tom is great, you know, he'll tidy your house and he's terribly polite and he's very helpful and he's lovely. And you think, well, why wouldn't you? And then you think, oh, wait, he's a robot. That is weird. And so it's, so you're constantly dancing between these, and Alma is sort of, you know, her, you know, she gradually softens and Tom is trying to calibrate and improve his algorithm so that he can be a better human for her. And so there's this wonderful sort of, yeah, I guess the sort of screwball dance, you know, of like, will they, won't they, should they, shouldn't they, what do we think, you know, but you get invested in them. And I think you know, Marin and I, she's such a beautifully naturalistic performer. And I think it was a bit of a shock to her initially to realize that her opposite partner was not going to be beautifully naturalistic, certainly not in the beginning. And so we had to sort of find our own rhythm, you know, peculiar to this film. Which I hope we found. But it was, yes, it was definitely, there was a moment where we both went, oh, this is quite unusual, you know.
Yeah. Well, let's take a look at another scene here from I'm Your Man with the two of you. And let's take a look at all that rhythm between you and that chemistry, I think, there.
Es würde dir besser gehen, wenn du netter zu mir wärst, wenn du dich öffnen würdest. Du wärst glücklicher.
Und dann?
Dann wärst du glücklicher.
Endorphine, erhöhter Serotoninspiegel, Dopaminausschüttung. Yippie.
Alle Menschen wollen glücklich sein.
Tja. Mach dir nichts raus, wenn dein Algorithmus da an seine Grenzen stößt. Das ist menschlich.
Yeah, you know, that's human, she says there. But that's one of the big themes here is what is humanity and what is that? And there are other big themes here, too. What do you think this film is saying overall?
Yeah, I think the film asks a lot of questions. The film plays around, you know, something we are all busy with, how to solve this the state of loneliness. And you know, there were, for the longest time, relationship wasn't even a romantic question. You know, it was about economics. Marriage was about survival, right? And then it became this big romance thing. And then people thought it's a godsend, or, you know, people died of broken hearts. And now we are in the times where we try to organize everything for ourselves, and we have the dating apps, and it's a very, you know, it's a small step to imagine that there will be creatures we can purchase, we can buy to be our companions, and we can even program them and tell them how to behave to make us happy. And that is as comforting as terrifying, I think. And we have these two concepts in the movie, Alma being a very romantic person, in fact, and despising the idea of love to buy, and, you know, having a tool to fulfill your wishes. She's very demanding because she experienced love. And then we have a person who openly admits that all his life was lonely and that he never felt so happy like with this new tool. So I think it's also a question of, you know, I really do believe that this might be happening to society. And the question is then, what do we gain and what do we lose?
Yeah. For you, Dan, you know, when you do comedy, you know, some people look at comedy, just make me laugh. And that's, I think the best comedies are the ones that have a lot underneath it all. And comedy is a great way to do that. It's often undervalued.
Yeah, I think it's a great playground for philosophy and for big ideas, you know, and actually with a little bit of lightness and silliness thrown in, you can actually kind of lead people into a very interesting position where they're forced to consider things in a totally different way. And I think, you know, the very surprise that this isn't a story about a robot that suddenly turns around and kills everyone is kind of, you know, it sort of sets it apart from a lot of films that are similar to it. But yes, I think, you know, tonally, you know, it was wonderful having Sandra Hüller in the film, who was so brilliant in Tony Erdmann a few years ago. And I think that, you know, that was a film that really ask some beautiful questions about, you know, the modern world and about, you know, what we're doing to ourselves and relationships and things like that, but also managed to be, you know, absurd in places and very, very laugh out loud funny. And I think, yeah, this film, you know, has a similar sort of tone in some ways, and that it's very, very moving in places. It really forces you to consider huge questions about humanity.
I think it's great that Germany chose this film. I think now is the right time, and you can tell it's going international and people are really responding to it. That we're looking for some, we want to laugh, but we also want to think about our own humanity now, you know, and where we're at. And this movie is not that all.
It's definitely a time that we've been, you know, I think all of us have been wrestling with very, very big questions, not just about ourselves and our sort of domestic life, but, you know, about where we are. And I think, yes, a film, you know, that was what was so delightful about this screenplay, frankly. I read it in the spring of 2020, perhaps at the sort of, you know, peak frenzy of global introspection. You know, it was it really spoke to me on that level.
Yeah, actually, I had heard it was sent to your agents and they said, we don't know what this is, but here, yeah, you know, you figure it out and let us know. The subtitles here, I have to say, are even more important than usual in a foreign language movie. Maria, can you talk about how you did that? Because that is, you know, it's an end product, essentially, of your movie, but so important if you're going to play it outside of Germany.
Yes, it's so interesting. Because I do believe I can communicate in English, right? But then there is this native feel to it. I can just not estimate, you know, if it's very well translated, if it's okay translated. So I just had a couple of people, many people actually, a handful of people to trust and to go over the subtitles who were capable of speaking German as well as English as native speakers and tell me, no, the jokes, the sophistication, it's very well translated and I have to trust others for this.
I watched it with an audience in San Francisco last night, in fact, and I think the international horror at having a bookshelves organized by color. I'm getting a Tom-like urge to come in and rearrange your shelves there, but I think you would be horrified. And it was just so funny to hear a San Francisco audience just laughing at that, at the visual gag of that.
Yeah, it's so great.
And I think that seems to translate around the world.
It definitely. And, you know, and you had to shoot this all in a pandemic. I believe this was one of the first productions, at least in Germany, that even was allowed to shoot, and you had the advantage, it looks to me, of having it all basically set on one set in that apartment set. So what was it like trying to make this movie in a pandemic here, Maria?
Well, it's you're absolutely right. Actually, the situation with COVID encouraged us to build the main set, building Alma's apartment to allow us to keep social distancing while working. And at the same time, it's very luxurious for the movie because you can switch from night to day shoots. And so that was a very concentrated and beautiful possibility. At the same time, you know, this movie is about love. It's about, you know, it starts out in a big ballroom with a dance floor and people getting very close to each other, kissing, flirting. How do you do this? Everyone was terrified, right? Yeah. So it was such an extra effort to make this happen. It was the last shooting day because it was the biggest risk day. And so they cast with so much extra effort, people who originally, you know, would share households and their private lives and then would be allowed, of course, after testing on and on, but to kiss in front of the camera. So after the lockdown, after half a year of the pandemic, seeing this ballroom and this liveliness and the careless, you know, approach and kissing and flirting was almost like it was almost melancholic, as if, you know, from a life which was, you know, from former times. And it was beautiful that we could do it. It was a beautiful and very responsible time to work because we also, you know, we cared about each other. We tried to don't take on specific risks. And we had a very short period of time. We had 22 shooting days. And wow. I remember it to be a wonderful a wonderful and very special time. Yeah.
That's so cool. Well, in the brief time I have left here at a half hour with, we always like to end it. And I want to ask each of you, what's the thing that you think that you want to tell an audience here to check this movie out? What's important for you to tell them to make sure they do it? I'll start with you, Dan. What do you want people to know mostly about this movie?
I mean, I hope it makes people laugh, first and foremost, because I think that's something we definitely need at the moment. And I also hope that they go away asking some big questions as well. I think those two things are my ideal outcome from almost any movie, I think.
And that's good, you know. And by the way, you do a mean rumba in this. You referred to that opening.
Thank you very much.
And it's terrific. For you, Maria, what do you want people to know most of all?
Well, I want people to enjoy it and to look at us, you know, us humans with forgiveness and tolerance, because we might end up with a species of individuals like Tom, who are just better in everything, and even though we think the humans are the crown of the creation, maybe we are not, and maybe we should embrace our imperfections.
Ah, perfect. Couldn't say it better. Thank you so much, Maria Schrader, Dan Stevens, and Bleecker Street. And you can check this movie out in all kinds of formats and things, and I guarantee a good time. Thank you for joining us on A Half Hour With today.
Thank you,
Pete. Thank you, Pete.